Good morning. Only a few words. I am Mr. Pere Puigcanglada. I am the delegate of the Catalan government here in Brussels. A few words about the seminar. First of all, we are talking about, I am representing Catalonia. I am not representing the Football Club Barcelona. And in any case, but if you want tickets, don't ask me. Ask directly Football Club Barcelona. In any case, good morning. Thanks a lot to be here. As representative of the government of Catalonia, I am very pleased to welcome to you in our delegation. As you know, we host here the institutional, economic, and cultural representation of Catalonia. Alongside the delegation, which is responsible for the institutional representation of the government of Catalonia, we have a number of Catalan agencies for tourism, culture, and business. It's in our interest hosting events like this seminar in our premises. Because the participation of Catalonia is important, because as you know, Catalonia, in this moment, we are in an interesting process, and we will see today what it happened, or what don't happen, or what happened, or how it happened in another part of Europe. As you know, the government of Catalonia, through its Minister of Justice, who is represented here by the General Director, is deeply committed to develop a common area of justice and criminal matters. For a long time, the European Union has tried to build the European Criminal Justice Area, but with one hand tied behind its back. Why? The unanimity rule, which requires an agreement of the all European governments for decision making, often led a lowest common denominator, very classical, and the Commission did not have enforcement powers. Also, the national parliaments and the courts had little to say. Progress in this field has therefore been limited, and the primary focus has been on security issues. However, with the entry in force of the Lisbon Treaty, our rebalancing between security and justice is finally possible. With the final abolition of the pillar division, the Lisbon Treaty corrects the pitfalls of the former system and enables us to create a common European area of justice, where national law, enforcers and judiciaries can trust and rely on each other. Finding common alternative ways to imprisonment to effective and enforce law at the European level can reduce recidivism rates and contribute to social rehabilitation of offenders. This is precisely what this seminar is all about. I shall stop here and pass the floor to Mr. Kilsing, Chair of the European Forum for Restorative Justice. But before doing that, let me first thank the members of the Criminal Justice Platform Europe for organizing this interesting event and for choosing our delegation for this seminar. Finally, thanks also to the representation of the Minister of Justice of Catalonia. Thanks to all of them. Thanks to you. And also thanks to Mr. Cerón. As you know, is, deus ex machina. Deus ex machina. Thanks a lot, Mark, to organize here and to work for the Catalan Minister of Justice. We are not well represented, very well, and always represented. That is important for us. Thanks a lot. Good journey. We will see tomorrow morning. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Puigcanglada.
Thanks.
Mesdames et messieurs, dames en herren, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great pleasure to welcome all of you to this first presentation of the Criminal Justice Platform Europe here in Brussels. The platform is a joint initiative by the Confederation of European Probation, by Europris, and the European Forum for Restorative Justice. In the mainstream public perception, these organizations represent quasi-separate areas. However, as many of us know, this is not true at all. All of us have to deal with victims, with offenders, and at least indirectly, with the community as well. In particular, when it comes to victims and offenders, there are manifold and close links. Offenders are not only offenders, and likewise, victims are not just victims in the sense of an abstract, isolated category. In reality, there are often blurred, even mixed, sometimes also changing roles from situation to situation. Therefore, the implementation of the 2012 Victims Directive of the European Union is a logical common denominator in the activity plan of the platform. Since criminal policy became a new important area of EU policies, as we already have heard, it is evident that those actors which represent, so to say, the entire chain of criminal justice intervention, that is probation, prisons, and restorative justice, should cooperate closely together. We have to work within the framework and the rules and structures designed and provided by criminal policy. And it needs a dynamic alliance, such as the Criminal Justice Platform, to work closely together in order to reach a better criminal justice in Europe. Today's event is the first one of a series of public events in the years to come. The purpose is a double one. First of all, we would like to give you an introduction into the profiles and the work of the three platform partners. Second, we would like to present facts of relevance for a modern, evidence-based and rational criminal policy. This is, of course, a wide field, and not everything of interest can be addressed today all at once, only in a morning like today. Therefore, today the focus is on a particular area, and that is detention, its intended and its unintended effects. And the question, what makes offenders desist from re-offending and from further offending? Is it the prison experience or totally other factors? The two experts that we have invited, and who will speak in detail about these issues, will be introduced later by Mike Theron. Now, first of all, we would like to start with a short presentation of the platform partners, and therefore I would like to ask Annemieke and Kirsten and Willem to join here and come on the podium. Okay, so the first presenter today is Kirsten Havlicek. She is the Executive Director of Europiris, and in the next 10 minutes she will give you an introduction into the work and the structure of the organization.
Thank you, Michael. Thanks also again to the Catalonian delegation for hosting us, and thanks to all of you for joining us here. It's always a pleasure, as the youngest organization, to get the word as the first speaker. The youngest Europris is only around for a little more than 2.5 years. And so the question is, why was Europris established when it wasn't there for such a long time? Well, actually, I think the question is, I'm still amazed by the fact that Europris was not there for such a long time, because there are a lot of organizations, European organizations, well, like my partners here on the table, but you have European organizations of lawyers, of judges, but there was nothing for the prison service. And looking at some figures from the prison service, there are 1.7 million prisoners across Europe. It's a huge number. That also means there are lots of staff working in prison systems. Only in the Netherlands you have about 15,000 persons working in the prison service. I mean, it will be a bit less after the current budget cuts, but still it's huge numbers. So it involves a lot of people. And I've put some other numbers here, like there are 150 inmates per 100,000 inhabitants, just to demonstrate how important and large the field of prison services is. There are a lot of similarities. Every country has a prison service, but there are also a lot of differences. For example, the average expense for detention of an inmate is 103 euro per day. But if you look, for example, to Bulgaria, from the most recent figures of the space questionnaire, Bulgaria is spending 3 euro per day per prisoner, and Sweden is spending 300 euro per day per prisoner. So there are lots and lots of difference. And actually, prisons, this is the society, it's the same as what happens in prisons, it's the same what happens in society. It's just in between walls, which makes things much more complicated. And I think it very much justifies that an organization like Europris has been established to exchange experiences. So who are we? We are a non-governmental organization, although all our members are government institutions, but the organization itself is non-governmental. We are non-political, and we are very much an organization for practitioners. So we want to listen and serve the needs of the prison practitioners. Our members can only be national prison services, so we don't have individuals, universities, other NGOs. It can only be the national prison services, and they can come from all the whole region of the Council of Europe, with a bit of focus on the EU countries. So most of our members currently are from EU countries. We have an international board. The board consists of director generals of European prison services, and we try to keep in the board and also in the member countries, as far as we can influence it, a balance between north, south, east, west, because there are particularities for all these regions. And we have a secretariat which is based here in Brussels, and we have the head office in The Hague in the Netherlands. Our mission is to be the recognized authority on prison practice and expertise. We want to be this authority not just for the prison services, but we hope that other organizations in the future will also see us as such, other NGOs or universities or organizations active in the field of prisons. We want to be the voice of the prison professionals, and we want to promote rights-based imprisonment. So we are the promoter of the standards that are set by the European prison rules and by the UN. All of this we do in order to achieve improve public security and safety. And that is done by improving the detention standards and practice, by reducing reoffending, and by advancing the professionalism of our staff. Another word for being the recognized authority, we would like to be a one-stop shop of prison. So that means we want to collect the information, we want to have information. If you don't have the information about the prison service that is needed, then we know where to find it. We have a very good source and network of experts, or we know how to find experts. We have contact with all prison services. So that is how we see ourselves and how we want to develop on the long run. We are a network organization, so network organization not just for the prison services, but again also for other activities that are prison related, because there have been initiatives, or there still are initiatives, like you have the European Prison Regime Forum, you have the European Prison Training Academies. These are all subject-related initiatives, and we want to connect and link with them as well. So networking in order to get better knowledge, cooperate closely, and all of this basically to build trust between the prison services within Europe, which is also very much a focus of the European Commission. And so what do we do, in fact, to get all this done? Well, workshops and expert meetings is a very important part of our activities. This is where we bring experts together to share experiences. And we do this in a very practical way. We do smaller events, so not like big conferences, but we want to really have practical exchanges of experiences in small expert meetings, in workshops. And what we see is that the experts are really enthusiastic about talking to colleagues that do the same in a prison service in another country and to whom they haven't talked before, because they don't want to reinvent the wheel and they can learn so much from what their colleagues do in other countries. The topics that we have done in the past 2 years were the transfer of prisoners under the European Framework Decision 909. We have an expert group there, and we deal with issues like foreign nationals in prisons, staff training we do together with CEP. The use of digital technology is a very, very large topic also in prison services, where we have very useful expert meetings and workshops. And so just to name a few, we also get a lot of questions from prison services. Sometimes simple questions, like a country approaches us like, do other European prison services have mother and child units in their prisons? So then we developed a system to set out these questions and report it back to our members. But in order to being able to answer these questions quicker, we built a system, an online digital database, which is called EPIS, European Prison Information System, which is completed by our members and can be consulted by them. So also in order to exchange information quicker. We are increasingly asked to participate in international cooperation projects to share experiences that are coming out of these projects, but also very important for us to know what is happening in Europe, what kind of activities are taking place, because there are lots of projects taking place and it's very important to link them so that there's not so much duplication going on, but that you can link activities that are taking place in Europe in the field of prisons and corrections. Of course, we support the European Commission in the implementation of the legislation, like the directive I mentioned on the transfer of prisoners, and we work with the Council of Europe in adding practical experience to the policy recommendations that they develop. We have a website, europris.org, where you can find lots of interesting things, and we have a bi-monthly digital newsletter, and if you're interested, you can subscribe to it on our website. Okay, networking with other organizations, I already mentioned it shortly. Yeah, I have two more minutes, that will be sufficient. Networking, so I want to come also to the Criminal Justice Platform, because this is one of the networkings that we do. It's all about public security and safety. And public security and safety is not just achieved by locking people up in prisons. This doesn't solve the problem, because you have to think about who's coming out. Most of the people are coming out. They are not staying in prison. So whom do you want to have at the streets at the end of the prison sentence? And that is a question that the prison service cannot answer alone. So you need an integrated approach, you need integrated programs for the offenders from the very first day that they are in prison. And this integrated approach was a reason that we also decided to cooperate in the Criminal Justice Platform and set this platform up, because we are three organizations working in probation, in restorative justice and prison, so that's very important. And one of the issues that we chose in our cooperation is the European Commission's directive on the protection of victims. And then very often I get this question in the eyes of people: victims and prisons, does this have anything to do with each other? What does prison service have to do with victims? Well, in the first place, if we reduce reoffending, we have a safer society and we have less victims. I mean, as simple as that. But prison services indeed paid in the past very much attention to the offender only. And this is changing, luckily. So what can prisons do? Well, treatment programs, including restorative justice processes in the prison, has been proven a very good effect on reducing reoffending. Taking the interest of the victims into account when placing a person in which prison do you place a person in, leave arrangements, taking the interest of the victim into account, but also informing the victim. Inform the victim where is the prisoner placed. Inform the victim about when he's getting out of prison, when he's on a temporary leave, and inform them in a way that it is understandable to them. So not in a very judicial language, but that they really can understand. And also inform them that they know where to get the information and that they don't have to run to 10 different places until they get what they want. And sometimes also just inform them what does it actually mean to be in prison, because that can also help. Well, all of these questions we cannot answer alone. We can only answer them with the other players that are here on the table. And that is why I think the Criminal Justice Platform is very important. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kirsten. Next on the program is Annemieke Wolthaus. She is the Vice Chair of the European Forum for Restorative Justice. And I'm confident in 30 seconds we can start. There will be opportunity later to ask questions and also for a discussion.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Kirsten. I'm also glad to be here. Thanks to Marc Serón, who invited us, and to the Catalonian delegation for hosting us here. I'm the vice chair of the European Forum for Restorative Justice. I'm also a senior researcher at the Verwij-Jonker Institute, a research institute for social issues in the Netherlands. And I'm going to introduce the European Forum for Restorative Justice to you and also how important this Criminal Justice Platform Europe is for us. Those are the main issues that I will address. We have been founded in 1999. That happened at the KU Leuven. University in Leuven has played an important role, like restorative justice developments in Belgium as such have played an important role also in getting things going further at the European level. Ivo Aartsen and Lode Walgrave are, for example, important players and professors in that scene, still active in the field. We have an international orientation, although we are a European organization. We had our last biannual conference in Belfast in June, and there were about 300 participants from mainly Europe, but also from overseas. And our events attract also people from India till the States and Australia, so people from all over. What are our aims? Promoting restorative justice practices, and that's contains both victim offender mediation as well as conferencing. So we're talking about restorative justice measures where we want to bring together victim offenders, but also sometimes people from both networks, that they get to talk, that they share views and also ideas how to solve conflicts. We also focus on its development, on research, on implementation. Our members are both individuals, and that is a variety of both practitioners, academics, policymakers, researchers, but also institutions. And we have many different mediation organizations and other conferencing services, as well as NGOs among our members. Our activities are on different levels. On the political level, we do a lot of on awareness raising, campaigning, lobbying, We share country information. We work at EU level, at the Council of Europe level. We are also practice oriented. We organize trainings and summer schools. Every other year we have a summer school. Our next one will be in Lisbon next year. The last one was in Vienna, and we choose different themes all the time. Very actively, our members are involved in organizing those. Research is an important aspect of the work we do. I will tell you a little bit more about that. And of course, we organize also joint events, conferences, to be able to share information. This exchange of information, like what Kirsten said about the prison systems and services, is also very important in our area. Now, we have strong links with both victim services, probation services, and prison services, and that has been strengthened the last few years while we have found a closer cooperation with the colleagues sitting here next to me. And that is something very important for us as well. To show some of the subjects we're working on, I don't want to say that research is our most important thing, because it's not. But through research, we get more in depth and we get more knowledge about what's happening in Europe, because we have restorative justice practices all over these days. There's also legislation in place. But what is happening where and what is working well? You know, we also want to get insights in effectiveness. And also about criticism, because is restorative justice always the right measure? Eh? You have to stay critical about your own work. So some of the subjects are here. We have made overviews of the different practices in Europe. We have worked around social support. We have worked around crime prevention, about mediation and conferencing used in or after prison settings. Now, victims have played an important role. Current projects that we are doing have to do, for example, with accessibility and initiation of restorative justice practices. So what is important for a victim and or an offender when he gets an invitation? What should be in there? What is the right moment? What helps to increase accessibility to restorative justice practices? We also look into desistance, an issue that has been raised by Kirsten as well, and judicial training for judges and public prosecutors has been among our work in the last few years. We work on victims' issues as well. The Victim Directive has been mentioned already. That's an important piece of our work. I mention here just the 4 R's of restorative justice, which are important to stress, since they also show how interdisciplinary this field is. You work around repersonalization, about representation, about reparation and restoration, and about reintegration, which is, of course, in the end, that also when people get out of prison, we want to establish. The article in the directive that deals with restorative justice. And what do we want to get out of this platform? Now, we want, our main goal is to improve criminal justice in Europe as such, as a big goal. We want to work interdisciplinary. Together we are stronger. It's also as simple as that. All these partners in the criminal justice chain are important, and that counts for EU level, but also on the national level. And what I would like to stress is that communication is such a central issue, like in restorative justice, like when we want to bring victim and offender together, and also the community, it is about talking to each other. What do we both need to be able to continue our lives? And now it's important that we hear all together, also EU officials and organizations like us on the table are doing that as well. These are some of the issues that we can work on together. But I think it's enough for now, and I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Annemieke. And the third partner in the Criminal Justice Platform Europe is the Confederation of European Probation. And the organization will be introduced by the Secretary General, and this is Willem van der Brugge. Please, you have the floor.
Sorry, the slideshow.
Good morning, everybody. I also like to thank the Catalonian delegation for welcoming us here. We've been in more. You mentioned Mark. CP is always a very welcome here at the Catalonian delegation. So thank you, Michael, for introducing me. My name is Willem van der Brugge. I'm the Secretary General of the CEP. And the CEP, does it work? Yes. I will tell you something out also about the background. We're the oldest organization. We're established in 1981, actually. But we feel still young. Actually, we were established by 10 Western European countries. At that time, we spoke about Western Europe and Eastern Europe. And I think that's important in this story. The concern at that time was a growing number of European foreign nationals in national prisons. And Kirsten was already telling about that subject. And I think it's still actual, still remains. We haven't solved that problem yet. Our aim at that time was the exchange of knowledge. And I think I can say that is still our most important aim for CEP. CEP organizes conferences. At that time, there was no internet, by the way, and there was no email, so we had to exchange our knowledge, well, the old-fashioned way. And we organized conferences, and we still do. 17, actually, over the last 3 years. And we host, nowadays, more than 15 websites. We have a knowledge base, and it contains more than 370 documents. So we still think that's important. And we have a newsletter now. We send it to 1,650 people every time. Talking about the conferences, that we have a long history and a lot of experience with it. We'll give you three examples, which I think are important. The end of this year, we will organize our ninth biannual conference on electronic monitoring in Frankfurt. And last year, we organized the first World Conference on Probation in London. And actual for this meeting is that next year, in September, we will organize a conference on restorative justice and mediation in Prague. If you look to the CEP today, it's much larger. We have 59 member organizations in many countries and many jurisdictions within the borders of the Council of Europe. For instance, Moldova and Georgia are also a member of CEP. But we're also open for organizations and institutions acting in the judicial field, like universities and individual members. And I'm happy to say, while we're in Brussels, that the University of Ghent just joined CEP as a member. Concern at this time is decreasing budgets. I think everybody will recognize that. What's important for CEP is that we collaborate with other network organizations, and my colleagues already mentioned Europeis and the European Forum for Restorative Justice, and also, of course, the EU and the Council of Europe, as Kirsten mentioned. But we also have affiliation agreements with other European bodies, like, for instance, EFUS, European Forum for Urban Safety, and APA, that's an American organization, American Parole and Probation Association, and they will organize the next World Conference on Probation in Los Angeles in 2015. If you look to the goals of the CEP, The first one is to unite probation organizations all over Europe and sharing the same principles. And we do a lot to achieve that. For instance, research or projects. An important one is, for instance, the criminal justice social work, which just ended. It had developed a curriculum, which we hope all probation organizations within Europe will use. There are about 50,000 probation workers within our member organization. But they have a different background. For instance, in the Western Europe, there's social workers. And in, if you go to Eastern Europe, there are criminologists, psychologists, sociologists. They have a different background. But we all have to share the same principles, we think. So we think that's one of the standards we have to promote. Because we want to professionalize the sector of the probation in Europe. And of course, we want to raise the profile of probation all over, also for us institutions as the EU of the Council of Europe. And one of our aims that we never lost is promote social inclusion of offenders through community sanctions and measures, such as probation, community service, mediation, and conciliation. If you look when we started in 1981, community sentences were introduced in Europe at that same time, and it's still actual. Actually, in June, we organized a conference on the development of community sentences in Eastern Europe, because we still think it's a good answer, good alternative for detention. If you look to developments in European probation, and now I have to look out because I like history. Probation is very old, or as a Dutch famous historian told me, you can say the history of probation and prison is the history of Europe. And I think it was Churchill who repeated that in 1910 when he said, if you look to a country and you look how they treat their offenders, you see how you can see the state of democracy. I think it's still active. There were a lot of initiatives, well, let's say 200 years. And in the Netherlands was the first. And the last one is in Albania. But we hope they still share the same principles. If you look to probation acts, and that's really curious, in 1907 it was in England and Wales, in 2010 it was in the Netherlands, some years later it was in Switzerland, in Belgium it was, I think, the end of the 1900s. At that time there was no internet, there was no... how did it come that everywhere in Europe at the same time people were thinking about probation? Community sanctions were introduced in 1972 in England and Wales, and now over Europe. What works? Evidence-based working. Risk assessment tools were introduced in 1990. Important, Kirsten mentioned the European prison rules. We have, of course, European probation rules. And now they're a standard for probation organizations. And I know young probation organizations in, for instance, Eastern Europe, use them when they establish their organizations. We also mentioned, my colleagues mentioned, the importance of the framework decisions. And for probation, 947 is important. It's about the transition of probation sentences from one country to another. It's a, by the way, it's a long and winding road to implement the frame decisions in Europe, as we know. One of the last ones is, of course, the EU Directive on Victims, which is important also for probation organizations. My colleagues on the table here already told that. And there's a large difference between the old organizations on probations and the new ones. For the old organizations, if I talk for the Netherlands, they're very offender-focused. If you go, for instance, to the young organization, the Czech Republic, victim support is part of the organization. All probation officers know it's part of their work. The Western Europe has to make more steps to implement the victim directive in daily practice. One of the last one, and that's important for us, is the recommendations on electronic monitoring. Why do we use it and how do we use it? It's about ethics. Is it always a good measure? How long should we use it? We're very glad that the Council of Europe accepted the recommendations on electronic monitoring. Now, if we look specific to the victims directives, I think it's a challenge for probation. Probation's ability to engage with the offender, the knowledge of the judicial system, and being active in the community means that probation services can ensure that victims' perspective is taken into account, for instance, through court reports, and provide information to the offender. Sometimes offenders don't know that there is something like victim support. They can prepare the offender for victim or offender mediation. And in the end, they can deliver victim or offender mediation. My last slide is, how can CEP promote this agenda? I think we have to develop a coherent and integrated strategy at the European level. We have to be proactive on implementation of the directive towards our members. As I told you, there's a difference between the states. But it has to be a balanced approach, both victim and offender oriented. Probation has to deal with offenders, not only with the victims. What's our key for success? I think what's important is a joint approach with our European partners from Restorative Justice and Europris, the criminal justice platform. And that's why we're here. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Willem. I hope that you have now a good impression about the organizations, the work, the missions that are behind those organizations. And now I will introduce the second part of our event. All the presenters from the panel are with us during lunch, so if you have more questions, if you like to have more information, we are all ready to answer your questions. And at the end of this morning, we will also have a discussion round. Now I will hand over to Marc Serron, who will introduce you to the two speakers of this morning. And I'm happy that I can hand over quite on time. Thank you.